Hello and welcome to today's worship service from Margate Baptist Church. We begin today with some words from Paul's letter to the Philippians. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. As we meet online today, we come to worship and celebrate the love of God in Jesus, the love that brought him among us as a man, the love that took him to the cross, the love that raised him up to resurrection glory, the love that exalts him on the throne of heaven, the love that reaches out to every one of us and makes us one. May his love unite us and enfold us. Shall we pray? Lord God, we worship and praise you for your amazing love. Thank you that your love has no limits and no conditions. Thank you that your love is stronger than the problems we face and deeper than the uncertainties we endure. Thank you that your love became flesh in Jesus, and that you are with us now by your Holy Spirit. Bless this time of worship, we pray. Forgive our sins, and draw us closer to one another and to you. And we ask this in the mighty name of our Saviour Jesus. Amen. Well, we're now going to sing a song of worship that I'm sure you will all know very well indeed, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. And it's led for us this morning by the Northern Baptist Association's Big Sing. And after the hymn, we're going to listen to this morning's Bible reading as Andy Foster brings it to us. But first, let's join together and sing, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
Thank you. The reading today is taken from Psalm 86, verses 11 to 17. Teach me your way, Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness. Give me an undivided heart, that I may fear your name. I will praise you, Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever. For great is your love towards me. You have delivered me from the depths, from the realm of the dead. Arrogant foes are attacking me, O God. Ruthless people are trying to kill me. They have no regard for you. But you, Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Turn to me and have mercy on me. Show your strength on behalf of your servant. Save me because I serve you just as my mother did. Give me a sign of your goodness that my enemies may see it and be put to shame. For you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Amen.
So this morning we are continuing our series on rediscovering God. And I want us today to think about God's amazing grace. Some time ago, I received a leaflet which said this: you can claim a free copy of this amazing book. Just complete the attached slip and send it off to our address, and we will send you your free book right away. Well, the offer sounded great and the book looked good. Who doesn't like a free offer? So I started to fill out the slip. And then I noticed right at the bottom, in very small print, the following words: all you will be required to do is purchase at least one book a month at full price from the selection that we will send you, and this book can be yours absolutely free. Ha! It sounded too good to be true, and it was. We all know the old sayings, don't we? There's no such thing as a free lunch. You get what you pay for. There's always a catch. No wonder we're all becoming so very cynical these days. We know that you don't get anything for free. But then along comes God and he says, I love you so much that I want to give you a free gift, the most amazing free gift that there could ever be, a gift that you really don't deserve. But I want to bless you and I want to forgive you and I want to share eternity with you. And the best thing of all, that this is totally free. You can't earn it. You can't deserve it. All you can do is receive it. Why? Why does God do this? The answer is because of his amazing grace. Yes, he's an all-powerful God. Yes, he's an all-knowing God. Yes, he is an unchanging God. But you haven't really begun to understand God until you realise that he is a gracious God. Psalm 86 says this: you, O Lord, are a gracious God, slow to anger and abounding in love and faithfulness. A lot of people have an image of God as a kind of celestial policeman waiting to catch us out and punish us, or perhaps a nasty headmaster relishing the chance to prove just how useless we are. But that's not the God that we know and love. Our God is full of grace. It means he loves to be good to us. He longs to forgive us. He enjoys lavishing his gifts upon us. Just for a few moments this morning, I want to look at just three of the many ways in which God's grace affects you and me. And the first thing I want to say is that God's saving grace washes away our guilt. Ephesians 1 verse 7 to 8 says this: in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished upon us. This is really the heart of the Christian faith, that you and I and all human beings are basically sinful. We choose to do what is wrong over and over again, and we are guilty. We deserve to be punished. But Jesus came to pay the price for our sins. And because he died for us on the cross, God is ready to forgive us and to wash away our guilt forever. We don't need to carry around that burden of our sins and failures for the whole of our lives. God will wipe them away if we ask him. And it's a free gift. It's amazing how people try to prove themselves worthy of God's love. They try to do it by being sincere. They try to do it by being good or avoiding being bad. They try to do it by working hard or by living a life of good works so that God will approve of them. But in the end, we can only be saved by grace, not by anything we do or don't do. Only God's grace can wash away our guilt. Nothing else can. Secondly, I want to say that God's strengthening grace reshapes our lives. Here is something really important to understand. God loves us just the way we are. But he loves us too much to leave us just the way we are. He wants to reshape us, to remould us, to remake us, so that we change from being who we are now to who he wants us to be. This is a lifelong process as God's Spirit gets to work in us, gradually transforming us by his grace into the likeness of Jesus. Theologians call it sanctification. It's the process of making us into his saints. To use biblical language, God is the potter and we are the clay. And God wants to reshape us until we become the perfect form of who we are meant to be. But unfortunately, all too often, we don't really want to change. We quite like the sinful, selfish forms of ourselves. And sometimes we would prefer God just to leave us alone, leave us the way that we are. And this is where grace comes in, because we need God's strengthening grace so that we recognize just how much we need to change. Sometimes people talk about the Christian faith as if it makes you happy and content about everything in your life. Jesus loves me and everything's okay. That's the message. But there is something wrong with that. Yes, Jesus loves me, but that doesn't mean everything's okay. I'm far from okay. There are many things in my life that need to change, attitudes that I need to get rid of, relationships that need to be healed, motives that need to be purified. As Christians, you know, we need a degree of holy dissatisfaction with our lives, so that we're driven to change. If we're just satisfied with everything the way it is, why would we ever want to change? That's the way to complacency and laziness and self-satisfaction. But God's strengthening grace will enable our lives to be reshaped by his Spirit until we become the men and women that God wants us to be in his perfect plan. And then thirdly and finally, God's healing grace soothes our hurts. Paul had a health problem. We don't know exactly what it was, but we know it troubled him and caused him pain. 3 times he pleaded with God to take his pain away. But instead, God said to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, and my power is made perfect in weakness." There are many different kinds of hurt. There's the physical kind, like Paul's, and like maybe some of you are experiencing. But there are other kinds too. Emotional hurt, relational pain, hurt caused by injustice and prejudice and loss. Being hurt at times is part of being alive. And no one gets to go through life without some kind of pain to deal with. This past year has brought a whole new kind of hurt to so many of us. Loneliness, fear and anxiety about our families, about our jobs, our health and our futures. and sometimes the hurt of being separated from our friends and our families. What does God say to us about all this? Does he promise to take the hurt away? Well, sometimes he does just that. And it's not wrong to ask, just as Paul did. But more often, God will not just remove the hurt from your life, but he will give you the strength and the courage to face it. His healing grace can soothe our hurts and enable us to go forward to face whatever tomorrow brings. Saving grace, strengthening grace, healing grace. We need all of these from our gracious God. But perhaps even more wonderful is the fact that he wants us to be gracious too. God's grace needs to flow through me and you to all of those around us, our families, our friends, our neighbours, so that they too can experience what that grace means. So this week, try to be a gracious neighbour, a gracious family member, a gracious colleague, a gracious friend and fellow Christian. Love without condition. You are someone who has benefited from God's amazing grace. So why not pass it on? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your amazing grace. Thank you for your saving grace that brings us to faith in Jesus. Thank you for your strengthening grace that gives us the courage to change. Thank you for your healing grace that soothes our hurts and points us to the Saviour. Help us, even as we have benefited from your grace, to be gracious to others in our turn. So may your grace flow through us and bring hope and peace and joy to those that we meet each day. In Jesus' name, Amen. Well, now we're going to sing our final song today. This is Amazing Grace, and it's going to be led for us by Bob Zebua. And after the song, Karen Foster will lead us in a prayer for our nation. But let's join together in This is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, lay down your life, that I would be set free. Whoa. blessing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
The Archbishops of Canterbury and York have called the nation together to pray for the nation at 6 o'clock each evening. I am using one of the suggested prayers written by Pete Gregg to help us pray now. Let's cry out to God to move in power. Lord Jesus Christ, in these dark and difficult days, we turn our hearts to you. In ages past, you have delivered our nation from disaster. Do it again, we pray. Give wisdom beyond human wisdom to our leaders. Give strength beyond human strength to the NHS and all our frontline workers. Give comfort beyond human comfort to children and the elderly and all who grieve. Lord Jesus Christ, in these dark and difficult days, turn your face towards us, have mercy upon us, and heal our land, we pray. Amen.
Well, thanks to Andy and Karen and Bob for taking part in this morning's service. And thanks to you for joining us once again today. I hope you have a good and grace-filled week. And I hope you join us again next Sunday. Now, would you please join with me in saying the blessing on your screens? May grace, mercy and peace from God the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit rest upon us and remain with us, now and always. Amen. Bye for now, everyone, and God bless you.